like donating body organs, like body parts, does that any really real meaning in the afterlife, like negative or positive?
Question.
Okay.
Anubhav is asking, will donating body parts help me in the afterlife or help someone else in the afterlife? In whatever way. The question is, do we know this life? We are talking of afterlife as if life itself is so very clear and intimate to us. We do not know this life, but we are so very interested in the other life, in some other world. Do you know life? When are you thinking of the afterlife? Right now, here, in this life. Do you know this life? What do you mean by afterlife? And why must the mind jump to the thought of the afterlife? What is life? Is life about eating, breathing, walking, sleeping, procreating? Is this life? Remember, if this is life, then very soon technology will come up with humanoids, with machines, with robots, which will do all of these things. Breathing is a chemical mechanical process. You can have machines that breathe very easily. Digestion of food. All the impulses in the brain. Electrical, chemical processes. Any machine can do all of this. Walking, getting tired, procreating. You very well know of test tube babies. Machines can do all of this. If this is your definition of life, then this life is not living at all, because this life can be produced in a factory. But most of us are only that, very, very mechanical people, very, very programmed people. What is programming? Programming is when your reaction to a certain situation, to a certain input, to a certain stimulus has been determined in advance. That when such an input will come, you will give this kind of an output. That is called being programmed. Two chemicals never have a choice. You bring them together, they will have to react. Given a certain pressure and a certain temperature, this is programming. The chemicals are programmed to react. Is that life? Iron is programmed to be attracted to magnet. Would you call iron and magnet alive, though they are attracted to each other? Water is programmed to boil at a certain temperature. Now would you call that being alive? But that's how we live. Two chemicals react and we do react. The moment we sit next to someone, we react with that person. Don't we? We have no capacity for independence. We have nothing called a free will. We very well know that if someone utters this kind of word to us, we will get angry. That is like pushing a button in a machine. You push the machine will get angry. Most people never live, they are actually never born. They think that they are alive, but they are never alive. They die before being born. Such a strange situation. You are dying at the age of 80, and you were never born. See, someone called me up. I said, what? He said, today is my birthday. I know you don't follow people on birthdays. So I am calling you up. At least wish me. I said, alright, I am wishing you. I am saying, would you keep celebrating birthdays? Or would you ever take drugs? How are you celebrating birthdays? You are not even born. So how can I wish you? At least be born once. For 5 minutes. Your age may be 30, 40, whatever. But you are still unborn. The machine is moving around. It has no life in it. And that is the story of the entire mankind. Machines are moving around with no life. The female machine looks at the male machine and is programmed to get excited. The greedy machine looks at money and is programmed to get excited. Eyes and ears receive a certain kind of stimulus and they are programmed to react in a certain way. Nose receives a certain kind of smell and it reacts in a certain way. Hindu machine hears the sound of the temple bell and is programmed to react in a certain way. Muslim machine hears the sound of the azan and reacts in a certain way. Now the Hindu machine will not react to azan. The Muslim machine will not react to the temple bell. The male machine will not react with the male machine unless under special conditions. The Indian machine has a way of reacting to the American machine. The American machine has a way of reacting to the Iraqi machine. The Israeli machine to the Palestinian machine, and so on and so forth. All these machines have been thoroughly programmed. They are not alive, not at all. But they have been programmed to think about a lot of things, and afterlife is one of those things. And it's such a strange situation. A machine that is not alive at all is thinking about life and afterlife. Thinking about life and afterlife. Understand this. Thought is the movement of programming. Never say I am thinking. You only think what you have been trained to think. Either by the body, which is biological conditioning, or through social input and education. Thinking and understanding are two very, very different states. Machines can very well think. Thinking is a process, an analysis, which draws from memory and uses that information, processes that information in a particular way. Any computer can do that. Understanding is something totally, totally different. A lot of you sitting over here would be hearing what I am saying. Just hearing. A little better than them would be those who would be hearing and thinking deeply. But rare would be the individual who would be in his deep silence really understanding. To be alive is to understand. not to hear, not to think. Even this mic is hearing what I'm saying. The camera can translate my words from one language into another. What you usually call as understanding is again a very mechanical process. You just translate my words into your language and then you say, I have understood. No, you have not understood. We have just translated it. Let's first come alive. Afterlife, previous life, keep these aside. Life is right now, not in the past, not in the future. Life is right now. Go deep into it, be present to it. Maybe then you will not need to think about this and that. When you are immersed in the present, maybe the need to render in the future will decrease. The man says, donating organs. He wants to do good to others. Does he know what is meant by really helping? Does he know that? Has he really lived a life free of violence? Has he ever known love? But no, when he is dying, he is wondering that I need to donate my organs to secure something in the afterlife. Don't you see the greed involved here? The body is anyway dying. The kidneys and the eyes and the liver are anyway of no use to me. So why just burn them? Why not use them to get some more profit? And what is the profit? Some virtue, some punya in the afterlife. Will this work? Can this work? Is life about this kind of business, trade, exchange? You see, I am dead. My eyes are anyway useless. Take these eyes and in the next birth, let the richest man be my father. So that I can enjoy all the benefits. Whom are you fooling? Yes, you are trying to fool God. That's the extent of human cunningness. Trying to fool God. Yes, but then the question of afterlife will not arise, right? Yes, but then the question of afterlife should not arise. The question right now is, what is the link between donating organs and afterlife? Then you are doing it out of your own joy. I want to give something and I don't expect anything in return. And that kind of mind will not drop from the skies at the time of death. You must live life like that. Your death will only be of the same quality as your life has been. In your entire life, if you have been programmed and greedy and violent, will you suddenly become compassionate and loving at the time of your death? Is that possible? Violent life, violent death. Peaceful life, peaceful death.
So, you just said that we feel that we are alive, but we are not actually alive. We are not yet born. And going by this, how do we actually bring our ideas to life, our thoughts to life in a society where even a different opinion and people are ready to kill you?
What's the name?
Bilal.
Bilal, you are not getting me. Bilal is asking, sir, you said that we are not yet born, we are not yet fully alive. So he's asking, sir, I agree, but how to bring our thoughts and ideas to life? I'm not saying that your thoughts and ideas are dead. I'm saying you are not yet born. The disease is deeper. It's not that you need to fructify your thoughts. It is not that you need to implement your ideas. The thing is that thoughts and ideas both are coming from a dead conditioning. Even if you implement them, nothing will change. Even if you implement them, nothing will change. Because those thoughts and ideas anyway don't have any life in them. Do you understand life? Life is the action of spontaneous intelligence, not a carryover from tradition. What you call as your thoughts and your ideas, please, it's a humbling realization. But do look at it. What you call as your thoughts, your ideas are not at all your thoughts and your ideas. They have entered your mind from somewhere. No thought, no idea is a fresh idea. Understanding is fresh. Thinking is never, never fresh. Thinking is like going around in a closed room. By going around in a closed room, wherever you go, you still remain within the room. And howsoever much you travel, you can never get out of the room. Because you have said that this is my limit. This room is past. Thinking always goes around in past. In the world of objects, appearances, the world. That's what thinking does. So never take thinking too very seriously. Never take opinions very seriously. Immersion is a different thing. Meditative attention is an entirely different entity. Do not confuse thinking with them. A simple thing. As I am speaking to you, if you are really with me, you could not be thinking. And if you are still thinking, then you can never understand what is happening. Have some of you seen this? That when you are listening intently, in that moment, there is no trace of thought. And the moment thinking starts, then there is only thinking. What is happening in the present, that gets lost. Is that not so? Is that not so? Thought cuts you away from reality. Presence brings you to the real. Just sitting on these chairs is not sufficient. Presence is an entirely different thing. And presence does not mean, again, that you are analyzing or comparing what I am saying with something else. Presence does not mean that you are thinking about it, you are dissecting it. Presence means just being, and that is being fully alive. One with the happening, undivided.